I'm going to talk about movies. Specifically, two movies, both based on the same book. And objectively speaking, one of them was an abomination. The second, I think, was really good. And the point I'm making with this is just because you have read the book doesn't mean you know how the movie is going to turn out. Going from a book to a movie is non-trivial. And this book-to-movie challenge exists in biology too. So the book of biology, our genome, is this long sequence of four letters that encodes the blueprint of how our cells will grow and divide. And I can actually make a stronger statement than that. We know how to translate these letters to amino acids, so we know all the protein sequences in our cells. But that's not enough. Our cells live in 3D, and the actors in the movie of these cells are proteins. They hold up the cells, they catalyze reactions, they bring in signals from outside. And our understanding of how proteins operate and look in 3D is very poor. And we can't get to it just from sequence, not easily. And the thing that makes this worse is we are much better at reading the book than being able to get at the movie. Sequencing costs have come down at a pace faster than Moore's law. It's plateaued for a bit now, but still, our data sets of sequence have grown at an exponential pace. This graph here, the y-axis is on log scale. And we now have a few hundred million sequences. And even if you were to say, I'm going to restrict myself to sequences that are very different from others, you still have 60 million sequences across all the species. And the problem is, when you look at data sets where we know what the protein does or what it looks like, we have a lot less of it. So in gray here, what I have are three data sets that record what a protein looks like or what it does. And over the last 15 odd years, our sequence data has increased by 180 times, while our structure and function data has increased only by 5 to 15 times. And that is the grand challenge. How do you get to a protein structure and function from its sequence? And just getting structure is not enough. A single structure of the protein doesn't tell you everything. And this is obviously a long-standing problem, and one way we computational biologists formalize this is saying, I give you a sequence. How can I edit this sequence to preserve its structure and function? So for example, what could I change that amino acid to while preserving its structure and function? And the answer in this, as so often in biology, comes from evolution. So the sequence I showed you was the human myoglobin. And you can look at myoglobin in other species, and because those proteins look similarly and do similar things, evolution imposes that the important locations should not change or should change in a particular way. And the less important locations can change. And this is something we have known for a while. And in linguistic terms, what this is basically saying is that evolution imposes a distributional semantics on protein sequences. And when you hear the word distributional semantics, you want to think language models. Specifically, if you look at natural language models, one way we learn them is something called mask language modeling. I hide a word and I ask the neural network to figure out what that word might be based on the context. And some words fit better than others. That is exactly the formulation you can use to learn which amino acid can come in here. And the thing is, we were doing this before language models came along. The thing that language models do for us is that they can look at a much broader context than we were able to. And that makes all the difference. Because we now have these massive corpuses of sequences, we can do a lot better. And of course, just like natural language models, there has been a lot of complexity and growth in these protein language models. They're still not as big as the natural language models. One way protein language models differ from natural language models is that generation, like guessing the next word or the next amino acid, is not as interesting a problem as understanding, looking at the properties of the protein, getting its embedding. And in that, we have a way to address that book-to-movie problem. So, like I said, we have relatively limited protein data, and that has been a challenge in making good models of what a protein can do. But what we can do now is we can train these foundation models on these large corpuses of sequences. On that, we can do few-shot learning and transfer learning and get really high quality and accurate predictions. So I'm going to give you one example from the work we have done in our lab. So this looks at the problem of trying to predict if a particular small molecule compound you are coming up with or you know will interact with a protein target of interest. And this obviously is one of the fundamental problems in drug discovery. And for example, if you could do this well, you could look at the set of proteins or set of drugs that the FDA has already approved and you could repurpose them. Another thing is the reason drug discovery is so expensive is because so many drugs fail. We realize that they are toxic or they have side effects. And we could check that earlier in the pipeline if we could look at interactions. And the challenge here is obviously one of accuracy, but also scale. When you have these large libraries with hundreds of thousands of millions of compounds, and you want to screen them against the entire proteome of humans, you're looking at hundreds of millions, billions of interactions. And the training data here, like I said, is not that much. You have a few hundred thousand examples. And what you can do with protein language models is you start by learning a really high quality representation of what a protein is from that language model. And then you use that. And now, even with a relatively limited amount of data, you can get really high quality predictions. And we designed the model so that it can scale very, very well. And it's not just about accuracy and scale. It's also about understanding. So what our model does is that it maps proteins and small molecules into the same space. So we can say things like, this class of compounds binds with proteins with the P kinase domain. So you can then go and fine-tune that compound to get exactly what you want. This was something that biochemists would think intuitively, but it's something that was hard to encode, and we could do that. And of course, by having this access to the large language model, we can get very high accuracy. And we took a bunch of our predictions, sent them into the lab, and we got validation for high quality, very strong predictions. So the takeaway I want you to leave with is that applying AI to learn how to speak the language of proteins can help us make significant advances in drug discovery. A lot of this work is in collaboration with members of the Bonnie-Berger group, and in particular, the work I talked about was with Sam Slodzisky, Leonard Cohen, and Bonnie-Berger. That's it, thank you.